much. Thank you. Can I welcome everyone to the Justice Subcommittee meeting on policing? It's our 10th meeting in 2015. Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices completely? No apologies have been received. Our only item of business today, item one, is an evidence session on local policing, where we'll explore some of the issues on our recent visits to Dumfries, Elgin and Glenrothes. And I welcome to the meeting of Police Scotland Chief Superintendent Mike Leslie from Dumfries and Galloway, Chief Superintendent Angela McLaren from Fife, and Superintendent Kate Stephen from Moray. Welcome very much. Thank you for coming. And I want to thank you on behalf of your divisions for facilitating our very useful visits, which were back in June, I think. I'm trying to remember when they were. Yes, sometime in June. Go straight to questions from members, please. That's Margaret, and then Kevin, and then John, and then Elaine. And Alison, will I just put you down in reserve, right? Margaret.
Yeah. Good afternoon. I wonder if I could start with the issue of communication, which is so important to the effective running of Police Scotland, and firstly address the issue of being bombarded practically every day with a volume of things that apparently have to be looked at. If that's still happening, just the purpose of that and how that deflects really from the priorities that you would be looking at locally.
What I would say is that if you just indicate to me, I'll call you and your light will come on automatically. Right, who wants to start? Yeah. Chief Superintendent Leslie.
Yeah. I think in the first couple of years, yeah, that was the case. There was a lot of information coming down, but that's a byproduct of bringing eight forces into one to make sure that you've got a corporate response, a corporate outlook, and you haven't created, you know, 14 different forces because you've got the 14 divisions. Yeah, there's a lot of information coming down. What I would say is in recent times, I don't think we're feeling the same amount of pressure as we did in the past, and I don't think it's having any. We've got into a routine now, if that makes sense, and I think we've learned from the past and streamlined that process.
Okay, anyone else want to comment on that?
I'll just drift. Chief Superintendent McLaren, yes. Just indicate now, as I say, and I'll call you.
I think just to add to that as well, certainly from an operational point of view, so the daily business of operations, the information is really quite streamlined in that case, because we do have, as Mike's referred to, set processes within the divisions, and it's very much a case of people who need to know that information will know it, and just keeping it at the right level. So we have one briefing document in the morning for each division, so you know where your priorities lie, especially in terms of those operational priorities every day.
Just the same for you.
Just to echo with what colleagues are saying. Can I bring you to something more specific then? And that's, for example, in the Criminal Justice Bill, then there were changes to arrest and custody arrangements, obviously things that will impact on you very directly, yet there was really no consultation. And also in the staff survey, 70% of the respondents said they wanted more opportunity to influence decisions made. Could you perhaps comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the staff survey, obviously that's been published recently. There's now a period of, there's going to be a period of engagement where the organisation will engage internally with stakeholders, with staff, police staff, police officers, and we're going to develop an action plan that will then be communicated to staff to take that forward, so that we've got the organisation learns from what came out with that survey. I think in terms of the information coming down, I mean, I know for a fact we had at the start, we say for communities, we would have material coming down that would come down to us a week late. For example, the Freshers Initiative now, that was because down in the Fife and Galloway, it's a week earlier than it is in the central belt, but we've addressed that now. I mean, the recent Operation Monado for bogus workmen, we got the material arrived on time, the initiative was implemented, and we had quite a bit of success in the back of that, protecting vulnerable people, especially the elderly.
So it's a simple matter sometimes of something happening in different divisions at different times, but you were getting the briefings at one fixed time. Has that been all sorted?
I mean, the information for the Freshers arrived a week later because, as I said, the Freshers starts in the Fishing Valley a week earlier. So we'd get the information, would come to us as it was being sent out to the central belt. But now we've addressed that, we've learned from it and moved on.
Anybody else? Yes, Superintendent Seaton.
I think just to add to that, you know, with events diaries and national units that deliver on these, like the Safer Communities, you know, over the last 2 years, we've very much streamlined the processes whereby there's much more localism added to that. The Safer Communities SPOCs and each of the divisions have an input and meet monthly with the national teams. Right. So where there are issues like that, they can be addressed at that meeting and forecast so that everything's much more smooth and streamlined and divisions receive information when they require it in time for national operations or events or initiatives that are occurring across the area.
Particularly, you know, the arrest and powers, is that coming down to you? Are you being consulted on that in any form? Or were you consulted on the powers
Chief
of
Superintendent
arrest?
McLaren, you want
Yeah, I
to...
think the criminal justice side of the business, there's always change in criminal justice in terms of, you know, police warnings, recorded warnings, discretionary powers, change to process. Criminal justice field is very wide. What we have now, we have a criminal justice division, but again within each area, if there's a new procedure coming in, there'll be a nominated SPOC, a single point of contact in each of the divisions who that person will link in with. The criminal justice division do bulletins and provide information that can be briefed out in a personal way as well as in a written way. But there is a lot of information, but policing's always had a lot of information. There's always been a lot of change, and we've always been able to try and find the best ways to get that information out to our staff. But we recognise that the staff survey has picked up on staff wanting to be able to influence decision more, have less emails and certainly have more personal contact, whether that's with senior officers or across departments. And that's something, as Mike's picked up on, that we're looking at now as part of moving forward.
Just use one other example that's been brought to my attention recently, and again it's about communication. We're aware that last year when all the leaders spoke to the police, then there was the issue of maternity leave being brought up. It's 13 weeks in Scotland, 18 weeks in England.
Slow down. The issue of this committee is to deal with the
communication.
How Police Scotland as a single police force operates.
Yes.
That's the remit.
Yes.
Not that. So I have to
but
know
I think
that.
You must let
no,
me.
I'm
it's communication.
I'm in the chair, and that's a difference between what
it's
happens in England.
The police negotiating body reached an agreement on the 7th of October. It was published in the press on the 8th of October. Rank and file officers weren't notified of it.
Sorry, Margaret, I'm putting my foot down. The issue was how the Police Scotland is operating as a single force. This issue is about localism and whether there is a failure, and there were difficulties when the national force came in and losing local accountability. That is irrelevant to what this meeting is about today, and you cannot expect witnesses to speak to an issue, nor will I allow them to be asked to speak to an issue which they did not expect, because it's not within the brief of today's meeting. Sorry about that. So could I have another question from Kevin, please, because I know he's got to leave a bit early.
Thank you, convener, and for those of you that don't know, I'm from Aberdeen and deal regularly with Chief Superintendent Adrian Watson there. One of the things which was of concern to some folk was diktat being made nationally and you guys not having the flexibility to deal with issues in your own patches. And I have to say that from my own experience, there certainly has been flexibility to deal with some of the complaints that I've had in Aberdeen, and I would praise the force there for that flexibility. But in terms of dealing with local matters raised either by elected politicians or by the public, do you feel that under this new setup that you have the flexibility to deal with their concerns and to prioritise their concerns sometimes above the national issues that come your way?
Yes, who wants to answer that? Chief Superintendent.
Yeah, absolutely. I suppose I've had the benefit of working in two different divisions, since the start of Police Scotland. I was in Tayside before I was in Fife. And it's very much for the divisional commander and the command team within that area to deploy their resources where they see fit, where the demand is. In Fife, if I take back in Fife now as an example, we have a really strong community engagement system in Fife. We had that prior to Police Scotland. That still exists. So we have regular contact at a local level. Local people are able to tell us their concerns. They form part of our where ward plans are now local area plans. And I suppose that emphasises the flexibility locally in that Fife moved to area plans to fit with our seven council areas, which was a better fit for us. Very seldom would I say I've ever come across a situation where a local issue doesn't in some way fit with a national priority. So for me, there's never really been that rub about whether a local priority can be serviced. And certainly in terms of flex and resources, we flex our own resources locally. And I know my colleagues will be the same. If we have a particular issue in an area, we had a ward that was experiencing an increase in antisocial behaviour and violence, for example, then we have the flexibility to bring national resource in to assist us where and when we need it. But I certainly do, at a local level, feel I have the ability to flex my resources, and my local area commanders at chief inspector level have the same ability as well.
Yes, Chief Superintendent Leslie.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'll just add to that. Like Angie, we are coterminous with the local authority and the NHS, and I would make the point that, in my opinion, I think we've got a very strong working relationship with the local authority, with the NHS, and most importantly with elected members, with MSPs and MPs, and that, I mean, in the last 10 days, I've met every local MSP, the two MPs, and a number of the councillors, and briefed them on a matter, and that gives them an opportunity to, you know, to influence me or bring matters to my attention that they think that we need to address. So I think that there's a very, very strong working relationship, and I would also highlight the fact that in Dumfries and Galloway, we're in a continuous improvement group, and on that continuous improvement group is the chair of the local police fire scrutiny committee. So he sits on that group with the senior command team, and that gives him an opportunity to influence. He hears what we're looking at, and it gives him a chance to put in and contribute to the debate about where we need to go. And we had a meeting on Monday with him, and one of the issues we discussed was the special constabulary and how he's helping us to promote the special constabulary in the region.
Can I just supplement that? Because it sounds things have moved on to the 1st of June, but the note that we have in front of us from Dumfries and Galloway does admit that that there was a strong view amongst officers the leadership style of the National Force had softened, become more understanding the need for flexibility. However, there's a bit here about officers and councillors noted that national policies on road closures and charging of events had replaced local flexibility. Is that the same? Has that stayed the same?
That's
important to local
people. I'll give you the context round about that. Temporary traffic restriction orders, or TTROs, as they're known by police officers. What happens is if you've got a galley event, they have to apply for a TTRO to the council. The council will ask us to make a risk assessment on it, and then we'll make a recommendation to the council. It's up to the council what thereafter happens. And that particular, that example at the time relates to Kirkcudbright, where an individual thought he was going to get charged an extortionate sum of money. I think it was £1,000, when really it was £100. And the other point, and that was by the council, and the other point I would make, which I think is really, really important here in terms of TTROs, is that in Dumfries and Galloway, we have gala events through the summer that run every week, and in many occasions there's more than one or two on, and they get policed for free. There's no charge. They're community-based events that the police will put significant resources to, and there's no charge. And the charge for the TTRO, Temporary Traffic Restriction Order, is by the council.
So do you want to come in on that, Elaine? Because I'm sorry, it's your patch, isn't it?
No, well, Kirkcudbright isn't, but I'm sort of aware of it.
Round and about. Oh, I beg your pardon, Kevin. Let Kevin in, sorry. Just that you were
I'm quite happy for you to take Elaine in. I do have other questions.
If it's on that issue, have you anything on that issue?
No, sorry.
Right,
thank you. Obviously, some forces were ahead of the game in terms of ward policing plans, local policing plans. Now you all have to do these things. One of the things which often tells you the story about how a force and a community are cooperating is how involved the community is in formulating those local policing plans. Now, I wasn't at the visit to Elgin this last time, but the previous time that Mr. Finney and I were in Elgin, it seemed that the community council there had a fairly good input into the local plan there. They were happy with the formulation of that plan. Can I ask, do you feel that you are taking enough cognizance of the views of the man and woman in the street when you're formulating these plans?
Yes, yeah, Superintendent.
I don't think the position has changed any from the first visit in 2014 to the second visit when Mr. Finney visited us up in Elgin. And I would argue that, yes, we are taking cognizance of the views through various methods and areas, whether it's through, you know, the local councillors or whether it's at community council meetings. It's right down at that grassroots level where officers and inspectors are attending these meetings and taking the concerns of members of the public in the Elgin area, and they feature and form part of that process.
Can I ask about Fife and Dumfries and Galloway as well? Because obviously, as I said, Grampian seemed to be ahead in this particular area before the National Force was formed. So I'd be interested to hear how you feel that's going.
Yes.
I would echo Kate's comments. I think Fife was in a similar position. We had a recognised engagement model, which we've maintained through Police Scotland. We still have that engagement model just now. So I do feel that actually our engagement hasn't changed a great deal. We engage the same way as we did before. We employ the same methods. Certainly for the plans that we're starting to look at now, we're starting to bring that planning process back a bit earlier to give us more time to plan. So we've started our engagement locally, as my colleagues will have as well, initially with partners, and then we'll take that down to a local level. We're also looking over the next year to bring in more digital participation, because we recognise that, you know, a form works for some people, but for most people the best way now to put your views across is either through Twitter, through Facebook, or through some electronic method. So we're at the process just now of trying to work out the best way to communicate with our different communities in each area and how we do that digitally. So as I say, we're working through that just now. If we take Fife as an example, we've got citizenship groups in Fife that will capture views of far more people than we would be able to do on our own. So it's very much about not doing this in isolation, but looking to see what existing networks are there that we can tap into and put questionnaires out. And I was conscious of everybody's time, but taking that a step further, that's something that we're looking at doing, and how we can do that with our partners as well, because obviously local council are doing the same thing, NHS are doing the same thing. So we're at a stage just now in Fife, certainly, where as part of our coordinated efforts, we're trying to think of ways that we can do that on a wider basis across organisations.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, from a V Division perspective, like Angie again, I keep saying that we're coterminous, but I think there's a very, very important point here. For me, community policing, it's underpinned by policing by consent. You police with the consent of the local community, the people that you're policing, and you can never, ever lose sight of that. And from a Dumfries and Galloway V Division perspective, we very much being a rural community are very much tied into the local community through the area committee process, and it's been there for a long, long time through the area committee process, through the police, what was the Police and Fire Committee, now the Scrutiny Committee. And like Angie, there's a lot of consultation ongoing. Do I think that the consultation that we're doing gives us an accurate understanding of what the community is? Yes, I do. I do, because I think we've just developed it and moved it on. But I think it's a very, very important principle for community policing. We should not lose sight of the fact that we police by consent.
Do you think that some of the national consultations that have taken place recently have been as robust as some of the consultations that you are dealing with at a local level? And if not, how do you think they should be improved? Should you maybe take the lead in dealing with any national consultations as well as your local consultations too? Because after all, it's you and your officers that folk have day and daily contact with.
Yes, Chief Superintendent, yes.
I think again, I think, as Mike's picked up on, there's a learning curve with any change. I think with some of the national consultation that's taken place, it's very much been a case of at times top-down, at times bottom-up. If we take the control room as an example, when Fife, prior to my time in Fife, when Fife was moving control rooms, the team came into Fife, they did a presentation to elected members, so elected members understood what was happening. That was to our scrutiny board. And just this week, now that we've gone through that change, the scrutiny board have gone across to the ACR to visit, to understand how things are working. So I think there's a learning process with any change process, but I certainly think that, certainly when speaking to the elected members that I work with, they do feel that they have had an opportunity to be involved in these processes and have contributed to, at a local level, contributed to what's happening nationally.
Okay. One final question, Convener. Many years ago, when I served on the Grampian Police Board, I was perturbed to hear that restrictions were put on officers from talking to elected members. The officer who tried to put that in place probably learned very quickly that that wasn't a very wise thing to do. Could you give me an assurance that your officers, your constables, sergeants, inspectors have got the ability to talk to us openly and transparently, and as well as us, councillors, community councils, the entire shebang, because I think that is extremely important.
You're not going to get a no for that, but never mind, I'll let you put something
back. I'm asking the question, though.
You are quite the question. It's as important as the answer, yes.
I mean, I expect my area inspectors will be speaking to councillors on a daily basis, especially when something happens in the community. And for example, if we've got a community impact assessment running, that they'll get briefed doing it on it. And there's a lot of trust there because the relationships have developed over the years. And you can get into some quite detailed, confidential briefings with them. You know, because you've got that trust, they need to know because they're part of the community. Because if you don't tell them, it's going to come to them anyway. And if they're not cited on it, then it'll backfire on you. So I can only speak from a V Division Dumfries and Galloway perspective. That just... And I mean, Miss Murray's here today, so you know, that's not happening. I've got a counsellor on my continuous improvement group, so and he's getting warts and all in terms of local things that we're trying to improve.
Yes, I'll give you all obviously the opportunity to answer that one. Yes.
No, I'm exactly the same as Mike's seen from a Fife perspective. It's very much a case of at a local level that consultation takes place. If it's an incident that's ongoing, we'll have discussions. I encourage my officers to speak to especially locally elected members around about issues that are happening in their area. It doesn't make sense not to do that, otherwise it'll be a letter that will come in and we'll end up giving it to them to deal with. So that consultation and engagement happens routinely. It's business as usual.
Absolutely. I'll just echo what my colleagues have said. It's no different in B Division, Aberdeenshire and Moray. Absolutely encourage it. Encourage our inspectors, sergeants, constables to have that engagement at a local level. And as you've highlighted, you know, it hasn't changed, that engagement piece, since the inception of Police Scotland in the North East. It continues.
I'm going to call John. Because you mentioned community policing and it wasn't followed up by John because we went to Glenrothes, Alison McInnes, myself, I understand that you had an open-ended pilot scheme for two dedicated community officers in each council ward, and that was very popular. Is that still continuing?
Yes, it is. It's being reviewed at the moment. It is continuing. And as it says in here, it's, as I'm sure you would imagine, it's a very popular method of community policing, recognisable officers in the wards that not just elected members but community members as well can associate with. So it's under review just now, but it is working well.
Thank you. John.
Hey, thank you, Convener. Hey, good afternoon, panel. Convener, if I could just make a wee brief comment first before I ask some questions.
Depends and that is, where we're going with
I'm
it.
Sure you'll like it.
Well, already I'm on guard.
Yeah. I had the benefit of visiting Moray, and I'm grateful to Superintendent Stephen and our colleagues, in January 2014 with Kevin. And the records will show that there were issues that arrived there, but we were particularly impressed with the community support that there was for the constabulary. And for unforeseen circumstances, Kevin was unable to join me, but the same was the picture this September. And I think that's important to say, that that's vital in a community like that, there is the support for the constabulary. I had an informal discussion due to some technical difficulties. We didn't get the show on the road quite the way we thought it would. I had some informal discussions with the senior management team who shared their frustrations about the level of negative publicity. And I can understand that. That's my precursor to raising some of the negative issues that are in this report there. But I think it's important to say that at all levels, there was an understanding of the process of change and a real appreciation of the effort that was going in. And I'm sure the
situation... I feel I've just had an evidence session, but never mind. Yeah,
I'm sure the situation is measured there.
But
people would be surprised if I didn't raise the issues. So, Superintendent Stephen, in relation to that, there was an issue about some of the partners were more aware of some of the police activities than others. I'm sure that's something that you will have picked up on since our visit, or you will be picking up on it.
Sorry, what's your specific question?
Right, well, in relation to policing plans, mm-hmm. Well, let me just do it back. Partnership representatives have not been formally asked to identify priorities for local and ward plans.
I don't have the details specifically around who, you know, what partners you're referring to. It's obviously formed part of the engagement that you had with them while you were there, but it's certainly not something that's featured locally with us in relation to that or been highlighted as an issue from partners in respect of that. And as I said earlier, the engagement process with them is as it has been over previous years in relation to the kind of consultation and the engagement and informing what goes into the local plans, which invariably inform the national themes as well.
Sorry, I understood this was in the public domain and had been shared, but if not, I'm sure you'll pick up on the issue. The other question, which will apply across the areas, was officers suggested to us that they were under pressure to put reports to Procurator Fiscal when, with their knowledge, they didn't believe there was a sufficiency of evidence. Are you able to comment on that at all?
I know I've now been advised. What you're referring to is the note that we have on the visits, which is in the public domain. I'm sorry if you weren't aware that that's what we're in part looking at. So that's it, and I think that's what John's referring to. So just to put you and be helpful to you, John, please know. Yeah. Right, on we go.
I could comment. And let me just quote directly, officers were also under pressure to put some cases to the Procurator Fiscal without a sufficiency of evidence.
I suppose just an answer to that, if it's specific to the consultation piece that happened up in Elgin, I mean, we have layers of quality assurance in relation to crime management units and, you know, layers of supervision who review evidence on cases that go to the Procurator Fiscal, and it's ultimately down to Procurator Fiscal to decide, you know, what level of evidence is there. In terms of the pressure for officers, again, you know, it was highlighted at your session with officers. It's certainly not something that has been brought to our attention locally in that regard.
Yes, I would make the point that we have regular meetings, and it'll happen elsewhere with the local Procurator Fiscal. And they won't be slow in telling you if that's happening, because they don't want to see reports like that coming in, because it's a waste of their time. And they're busy enough. And the officers are busy enough without having to, you know, spend the time to do that. So there's a mechanism in place there, in my opinion, and it'll be happening elsewhere in Scotland with meetings with the Fiscals, where the Fiscals are not slow at coming and telling you when there's something that is catching their eye.
When you look specifically at, for example, domestic abuse cases, we've obviously got domestic abuse task force and investigation units across all the divisions, and it is new structures, it's new ways of working, there's innovative practice that's been developed in other areas of the legacy forces, which have been introduced into specific divisions for progression. So there's toolkits and standard operating procedures and all sorts of things there to help officers identify where, and ultimately it's to maximise the evidence that's available for them when they're presenting cases against individuals. So perhaps it was a view of a handful of officers in relation to specific types of reports that they're putting in, but in general, I would say...
I've just located it myself. It's at page 8, second bullet point down of the note of our visits. Yeah, you found it. That's just where John
and
is.
And to echo what my colleague was saying in relation to that aspect, we have regular meetings with the Fiscal Service on a monthly basis, in fact, through a single point of contact at all levels from strategic down in relation to that. And if there were issues that they were highlighting, because as my colleague says, they wouldn't be slow at coming to let us know when there's if there's a raft of cases coming through that don't have evidence. And ultimately, you're talking about human rights, you know.
Yes, indeed. There was a couple of things, and this was something that came up when Mr. Stewart and I did visit before, and it was And what I'm getting to is there may be issues of perception about, on officers' behalf too, about the level of micromanagement as it was seen in the removal of discretion. Are you able to comment on that? And indeed, it was domestic violence that was cited, that the officer spent a considerable time doing that. They come back, and I think they said five people in the office pore over their every action, often finding something else for them to do.
I think you'll recognise, and members will recognise, that domestic abuse is one of our priorities,
absolutely,
both locally and nationally. So. Mm. And I've mentioned before, there's Domestic Abuse Task Force and Domestic Abuse Investigation Units, because we recognise that this was a hugely underreported area in the past. So I absolutely make no apologies for the level of scrutiny and the level of quality assurance that goes in to ensure that victims are protected in all cases of domestic abuse.
Superintendent.
I think just to build on what Kate was saying, I think a lot of the time, especially with domestic abuse cases or cases involving children, a lot of that's to do with the recording process. So the officers might feel that there's five people poring over a single piece of information that they're recording, but a lot of that's just down to different recording practices. And certainly in terms of a vulnerable person's database, the information ultimately can be shared with other partners. So it's important that it's correct at the time of it going on. With domestic cases, they're often custody cases. So if that officer then goes off for 4 days on a shift pattern, if it's not done right at first point contact, it then just creates delays and issues further on down the line. But again, I would put a lot of that down to change process as well. When you bring in a new system, whether it's a different operating procedure or a different actual technological solution, there's always that adapting period of time.
I'll just add to that and make reference to we're on a MATAC process now for domestic abuse. And
what process, sorry?
MATAC process. It's a multi-agency task and coordinating meeting.
Well, we didn't know that, you see, but now we do. Right.
Yeah, I mean, and that's a very important process. Because I'll give you a good example of that working. We had an individual in the first 2 years, Police Scotland, who came to their attention through that process. And he was subsequently convicted at the High Court of 9 rapes and is now serving a 13-year custodial sentence. And those 9 rapes had occurred over a 10-year period. So that individual's now out of the way, and there's no doubt if we hadn't got our hands on him through that process, he would just have continued.
How did it get to that end result?
Well, what happens is it's a process that started off in Strathclyde, and every Thursday of the month we come together and we look at incidents that have been reported to us, domestic abuse incidents, and we assess them. They go through a risk assessment matrix and we identify high profile offenders that we think there could be other victims out there. So what you're actually doing is you're actually going after the perpetrators, and we proactively target them and build up the intelligence case. We then go in and interview who we think are the victims, and in that instance there was numerous victims over a 10-year period, and I think the indictment had over 30 charges on it.
What we're getting at is the multi-agency bit. Because quite often things go amiss because there isn't sharing of information, and that's very interesting. Did you share it?
We sit at the process. We sit there with housing. We sit there with the social work department. We sit there with a representative from the prison, and a couple others. And what that does is we share the information, so we get to know. We start to build up a good, balanced picture, and also with the advocacy service who are dealing with the victims, so we can build this picture up of who the high risk offenders are in the region, and it's happening across Scotland, and you can target them and get them in the best place for them, which is inside the jail.
There's a similar process in relation to victims of similar type crimes and incidents, whereby that support network, that multi-agency risk management group meets, and the support network is put, a support package is put around those victims in relation to those crimes.
Has the fact that we now have a single police force made that a better system, or is it the same, or what? I mean, that seems to me that so many things go by because people haven't shared the proper information fast enough.
About because it had been developed and implemented in Legacy Strathclyde, and then when we moved to a single service, that was obviously seen as good practice, and it was then implemented across the rest of Scotland.
Interesting.
But that case that I mentioned with the conviction for 9 rapes is not the only one. There's been several individuals who, through that process, have been identified. The cases have been built up. that then they go through the criminal justice system, and the vast, quite a few of them have had get quite lengthy custodial sentences at the High Court.
I think what I would add to that, Mike, as well, that in relation to the kind of local, national, regional and national resources, the task force, for example, we've got a team based in the north who cover the whole of the kind of north region. If there's a perpetrator who, as Mike's alluded to, who has offended anywhere in Scotland, they have that remit to then go and deal with that across Scotland. So it's not down to the local officers. That means that they can get on with the local issues, whereas this national and regional resource can then go and identify the victims, build up that evidence case, because they're that national asset and that national resource, and they have that power to go across, or not the power, but the ability to go across Scotland and across divisions.
Yes. No, I was just going to add to that. I know part of the Fife visit included Fife Women's Aid as well, and actually it's replicated in the document that, you know, partner organisations welcomed the work of the Domestic Abuse Task Force, especially in relation to historic cases. And, you know, it's not coming from us, it's coming from Women's Aid, that local officers have better training and are delivering a more consistent approach. So, you know, as well as us saying that it's our belief that things are improving, that's obviously Women's Aid who are echoing that.
You want to go on the same issue, because Alison wants maybe come in on that, or a different issue.
I think we went a bit off issue, to be perfectly
honest. Well, we're still back on local and national, and it's the balance, getting the local things dealt with locally, and where it can be an advantage for it to go up into the national. I think it's good
to record that there's a lot of really positive stuff done in relation to domestic violence and victims. Can I just, and to stress, Superintendent Stephen, these aren't my notes, these are the notes that are in the public domain. If there's officers spoke of...
Which page? So we can find it for
page 8.
Page 8, right.
Officers spoke of being micromanaged, discretion having been taken away, and a lack of trust. Now, we were also then told about areas where discretion had been exercised in relation to stop and search, and in relation. And I just wonder if there's a communication issue, and some people are in the loop for understanding the wider picture, and others aren't, and if that's something that's likely to be picked up on. No, it was to Superintendent Stephen. Sorry, yes.
Obviously, I can't argue against what, you know, the officers that you had the meetings with in relation to how they feel things have been in Police Scotland. What I can say is that in terms of the division, the engagement that we have at all levels, through the local area commanders, through the command team, at meeting with and communicating with officers directly. I know regularly myself and my colleagues are in the muster rooms speaking to officers, as you would do, as anyone does, but that flow of communication, it is a challenge, and there has been a lot of information that's come to officers. There is an element of scrutiny. Absolutely, there's an element of scrutiny, because we're all accountable for the performance of the division. But in essence, my view is that's healthy scrutiny, because it's a quality assurance. Mm-hmm.
No, I agree. Is there just maybe a need to reinforce why some things are happening? Maybe, you know, cops are busy folk. Maybe their minds on
absolutely.
On the
wider
picture,
I know certainly as a division we have a series of engagement events, if you like, with first line managers and with inspectors, and our message as a command team to the inspectors and sergeants is to go and pass that message back through to the officers. Perhaps there's an opportunity for us to actually have those engagement events with officers themselves rather than the ad hoc, just to ensure that we capture everyone.
That's great. Thank you very much.
You wanted to say something there.
I would just draw your attention to, from a V Division perspective, that under page 3, communication shift briefings were held at the start of every shift, and staff and divisional briefings were held regularly. Information was disseminated through the internet. So, you know, that's actually in there from the document from the visit to V Division, and that'll be happening elsewhere in Scotland, because there's a national process in place that's been implemented in terms of the briefing process. It was brought down the road by Chief Superintendent Eddie Smith, who's now in Tayside. They'd implemented it elsewhere and it worked, and it's now we've had that process in place. And I'd imagine that's a reflection. That comment there's a reflection of that.
Ultimately, change is unsettling for everybody, you know, and I think we have gone through an absolutely massive change in terms of coming into Police Scotland and processual change. It's a new structure. It is unsettling. There's new processes in place for certain things, for a lot of things, and it will be unsettling, and it is unsettling, and it's for us as commanders and command teams to manage that with the local officers, and where there are issues highlighted, we'll address them. Thank you.
I'll take Elaine next, then Alison will have you.
Thanks very much. First, just to say that I can confirm that the issue of communication, and I think that can be on the record or off the record. I think the matter of the flick sticks might be an example where an officer came to me with a concern about flick sticks being removed from vehicles, and I took it to CS. They've got a formal.
If someone's in distress or in water, it's a device that you flick a rope out that they can grab
and
then
get people out of water.
Yeah. I know you knew what you were talking to each other about, but the rest of us
to Police Scotland, and there may well be a good result for everybody, because it might be that all vehicles have these in the future. So I think that's the only addition to that is that T.S. Leslie phoned up my secretary to speak to me about flick sticks, and she misheard him and thought he wanted to speak to me about lipstick, which would have been rather unusual.
Would you like to deny on record that you ever asked him about lipstick?
Don't want to go there, then.
Well, that's not a denial. I'll be careful there. Yes.
Well, I thought particularly in Dumfries and Galloway and in Fife, of course, as well, where as both CS McLaren and CS Leslie have said, they were coterminous with the council, with the former police forces. I think there's been a feeling, certainly in Dumfries and Galloway, that the introduction of Police Scotland has resulted in a lack of accountability, that somehow the scrutiny, the accountability is not as it was. And I wondered if maybe you could give your view as to whether or not that is correct. Because I know certainly from the point of view, I think, of councillors and so on, there's a feeling that they don't have quite the same relationship with the forces they did with the legacy forces.
Yeah. So it's not just for Dumfries and Galloway, obviously. It's across all of your... We'll start with Chief Superintendent Leslie. I'm looking in a different way now. I'm just wondering which shade, but never mind.
It's a good question. I think at the start of Police Scotland, the committee locally in Dumfries and Galloway V Division they were trying to find their feet, and because it was a big change, they'd had a legacy force, and I think it took a bit of time. I've certainly seen the process with them mature in recent times, and I can certainly say that on the 30th of June, at the last Police and Fire Scrutiny Committee, I got some very in-depth, detailed questions from members on a wide variety of subjects. And I keep going back to the fact as well that you're trying to develop the relationships. Obviously, there was a change in the political administration down there, which I think had an impact as well, and they were finding their feet. I like to think, and maybe I'm wrong, that I've worked hard at developing a strong working relationship with the elected members, so that I keep going back. I don't want to keep repeating myself about the continuous improvement group, and that's for me is a good example. And the next meeting that we've got on the 10th of December, there's a lot of meaty subjects on that agenda that we're bringing there for members to give them the opportunity. For example, we know that the number of fatal road traffic accidents in the division's up on last year, so we're getting an input from the National Roads Policing Unit, so that'll give members the opportunity to scrutinise us in terms of what we're doing to try and reduce those figures and to give them a better understanding of what's happening in terms of the issues there for us.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Chief Superintendent. Yes.
Yeah, I think the other thing that I would pick up on in terms of scrutiny at a local level is that we all do it differently. So the processes are different across Scotland, dependent upon the council areas. And talking from a Fife perspective, it's a Safer Communities Committee that forms our scrutiny board. So it's not always just about policing. It can be about policing, it can be about fire, it can be about the actual Safer Communities Committee, the wider committee. That can bring in a whole host of different organisations, but all with similar outcomes that we're trying to achieve. So for me, even if I don't have a paper at that meeting, I'm not sure if my colleagues are the same, but if I don't have a paper, I still attend that meeting. It's still very much an interactive meeting where we actually are scrutinised, but are supporting our partners at the same time and trying to take business forward. And I think, as Mike's alluded to as well, I think the important thing from a scrutiny perspective is that it's about the relationships out with. So we get scrutinised on a quarterly basis, but that doesn't mean we don't speak to our committees in between times, don't discuss issues with them and with our wider elected members, but certainly don't feel that we're not scrutinised or ineffectively scrutinised. I think when you're the one being scrutinised, you certainly you're there to give an account of what you and your division have been doing. Some of us were at the local scrutiny summit that took place recently, and I think that was really helpful just to understand what was happening in different areas. And even just, I know from my scrutiny members that were there, they'd picked up on some practice from other areas that they felt was really beneficial, and looking at ways that we can maybe share different experiences across the board and see how we can look to improve things in terms of scrutiny. But definitely a moving picture, and it'll be interesting to see how the scrutiny assessment and the report into scrutiny progresses as we move forward.
I would just echo what my colleagues have said. I mean, by virtue of the fact that Mr Thompson couldn't make it today, he had scrutiny in Moray, which he has made a commitment to go to, and I think that obviously echoed in the report that Mr Finney's prepared in relation to that kind of level of partnerships.
It's not Mr Finney's, it was a report that was drawn together
following his visit, yeah.
If only he would prepare a report, but no, this is on behalf of the committee.
Absolutely.
Right.
Apologies, I don't, just referring to the paper that's in front of
me. No, that's a committee paper,
but,
right.
But certainly his, the commitment from a command team or as a commander, Chief Superintendent Thompson has made that commitment, and that's yeah. Where he is, and absolutely the kind of engagement at that level and the scrutiny level continues in a positive vein, and again inviting the national resources in to feed into that process, and indeed we've had two sessions with members of our scrutiny board in Moray in the last one in September and one in October to cover specific issues that they had raised at the scrutiny board, so out with the actual scrutiny meeting. So it continues positively in B division.
Kind of final point, and that's just about the fact that, you know, local democratic accountability is, in my opinion, is fundamental to policing by consent. It is. You've got to be held to account, and I really try to encourage the local team down there to ask the questions and maintain those relationships.
A few of us were actually at the local scrutiny committee. Quite a number of us on the committee were there as well. So it was interesting. I just wondered if I could ask for your views as to whether there is a potential for the devolution of more, both responsibility and also more budgetary control to divisional levels, at least. I mean, would that be of benefit in terms of being able to tailor the sort of policing and the sort of flexibility of decision making and so on, if actually further responsibility was given to local commanders?
Yes, Chief Superintendent.
Yeah, I think that in relation to that, we do have control of parts of our budget, so we are able to manage that, especially in terms of police overtime, police staff overtime. So that gives us the flexibility to move resources to where we need them locally to achieve a local priority or a local issue. So we do actually have that in place already. I suppose one other thing on scrutiny in terms of local and taking it even more local, probably the same as Dumfries and Galloway, Fife has local area committee. So as well as, you know, I'm being held to account at a divisional level for policing and safety in that area, each of the chief inspectors are also reporting at a local area committee level as well. So there are many layers of scrutiny. Obviously that isn't quite so relevant in terms of budget, but certainly in terms of how we are performing and perceptions of policing in each area, that's very much at a local level.
Yeah, yes, I would add to that and I think it's on page 3 at the top, I made the comment when we were seen on the 1st of June that, in my opinion, I feel that the organisation, the force, is maturing, and that we're having conversations now that we didn't have before in terms of certain issues. And I think that's down to the fact that, you know, at the start...
Issues.
Well, in terms of moving forward, the staff survey, the 8 forces had to come in to be one. So there had to be, you couldn't have 14 different sheriffdoms or chief constables. So I think 2 years in now, you can see we're having the organisation is maturing and is moving forward.
That I don't undersee issues in moving forward. Give an example that you're now able, you feel that local have more input, and not just input, yeah, are listened to and change things rather than top down, which is what you've been, you know, we appreciate it takes
a
while for things.
I think we're getting, there's more flexibility now in terms of looking at local priorities in terms of, you know, we've got a performance framework keeping people safe. I think it's now there's a bit more scope for us to look at. For example, we in Dumfries recently, we had an issue with youth disorder, and we got the opportunity with resources from the centre to do Operation Resolve, which was about tackling that issue, getting staff down from up the road to assist us with that, to increase visibility and to address an issue that was a concern for the community.
While you're on, then, give examples from the other divisions where you've managed to, you know, you've gone back into having your priority come top of the pops, as it were, instead of it.
One of the examples I would use is in relation to flexible policing teams, which were implemented as part of the kind of original Police Scotland kind of model, which is a team that could be deployed wherever in a division. In essence, in the north, particularly in A and B division, we didn't feel that was, because of the geography, that it fitted with what we required. That was fed back to the LVRD, which is the Licence and Violation Reduction Department and team, and that was reviewed, and ultimately a decision was taken that we could have the autonomy to retrieve those resources back into division and deploy them as we need to.
I hear that's about resources, but you talked about an issue in your area, which was the youth disorder. What would have been yours, for example, the recent one that wouldn't, you know, you've been able to pursue that rather than the national ones? Let's take domestic violence, yes, we accept that, but something in your different areas that varies. So we get back to local emphasis.
Well, again, but it touches on resources, you know, a very recent example I've had in Elgin, particularly in relation to violence and disorder amongst the travelling fraternity, securing national resources from the Violence Reduction Task Force, who are based in the Central Belt, based in Glasgow, and have a team of six officers up into the Elgin area for a period of 3 or 4 days, absolutely no issue to tackle that and deal with those particular issues very effectively. And again, it's just through that tasking process and access, equitable access to those specialist resources that are available to wherever you are in the country in terms of divisions.
And I suppose the other thing is, as well as having national priorities, we actually all do have our local priorities as well. So for Fife Division this year, we're looking at dangerous driving. But I think in terms of moving that forward a bit further, when we look at, we've obviously got a local policing plan, everybody be aware of that, it's a legislative requirement. We have a single outcome agreement in each area, and we also have community planning. But in terms of trying to tailor things as we move forward to make our priorities more local, we're now at a stage where we're starting to develop and think, well, can we take what is our local policing plan and actually make that part of our single outcome agreement? I notice, and I think it's perhaps in the D&G area, there's a talk about cluttered landscapes, because we have a lot of plans, a lot of priorities, a lot of meetings. And I don't just mean that from a police, I mean that on a partnership level. So this could be an opportunity for us to still have a policing plan, but make the policing plan more part of our community planning process in order to take that forward.
Alison.
One of the objectives of the legislative reform, of course, was to protect and improve local services. Just last week, we learned of the merger of A and B division. Can the officers tell me how they think that will protect and improve local services? And will we be sitting here this time next year learning of more mergers?
B division. I think the strengthening of divisions has been on the table. There's been extensive consultation both locally and nationally in relation to that proposal. I think personally speaking, as operational superintendent for B division covering Aberdeenshire and Moray, there is absolutely an invisible barrier between A and B division as it stands at the moment, where I would have much more, if I had access to those resources as well, where there's an issue that I need to address in B division, and I could utilise the resources that service Aberdeen City, it would make my job much easier. So for me personally, I think it will be a much more efficient and effective use of resource. We already have combined resources in relation to our intelligence department at a joint resource, our referral unit at a joint resource, coming in the pipeline is around the analytical support aspect. So there are a number of areas where we already share a resource in essence between both divisions, and I think personally speaking it will make my job much easier in terms of operational delivery at a ground level. That said, there is a commitment, and absolutely a commitment, that from local area commander level down, nothing's going to change. So you're still going to have your local policing teams in the areas where they are at the moment, your local policing inspectors and the area commanders as they stand. So in essence, it will make it much easier for myself as an operational superintendent to deploy those resources where it's required, where the operational need and demand arises across the area.
I imagine E-Division will be saying the same thing. So, and I'm much more likely that the city will draw the resources than away from the rural areas. Is that not the case?
It is absolutely a concern that is a concern that's been raised. But that, again, is for us as a command team to deploy the resource and maintain a resource where it's required. We're still going to have to, you know, we're still required to service calls in Buckie and Elgin, in Stonehaven, Lawrence Kirk. So, absolutely, there is a commitment that from local area commander level down, that will not change.
And the driver for that was saving money?
In terms of the strengthening? No, it was to improve local delivery of the service. Ultimately, there will be savings that will be made because there will be rationalisation. There are still some departments where we have two specific units, one in A and one in B. But as I say, much of our, a number of our areas are already shared resource. So there will ultimately be savings. But the commitment, again, is that those savings that are made will be put back into local policing.
I wonder if the other officers have a view on whether or not this is the start of a process that will see the divisions reduced over the next year or two.
I don't think anybody could second guess what the future of the 14 divisions would look like. I think, to echo what Kate's saying, and if I take Fife as an example, I think what's important in terms of local policing, it's not so much what sits at the top level in a division, it's what sits at a grassroots level within a division. It's having local officers being able to do their job at a local level. So having officers that have a ward responsibility, and we see that working in Fife. Tayside had a slightly different model, but a lot more, again, a lot of community officers deploying in each area. So whilst you might have a slightly smaller command team covering an area, I think what's important is that you have a model that suits your area, and a model that will suit one area won't necessarily suit another. So whilst you might have a division that was two old divisions coming into one, you might have slightly different models as a subset within that division.
I mean, the reality is as well, we'll still have the three local authority areas to we'll still be committed to scrutiny for all three areas. So we'll still have to service the requirements from the community and the public in the whole of the region.
Yeah, just further centralisation, it's hard to see why that, how that makes it more responsive. We spent much of today actually talking about the tensions between national priorities and divisional priorities, and now there's a further tension in it. If I've got time, convener, to turn
point on that.
Obviously, there's a new chief constable coming in, and they'll take stock. And there's going to be this opportunity for the chief constable to visit, as I understand it, various the areas during the course of the year. So that'll give an opportunity for local elected members to influence the debate.
One would hope Chief Constable would have visited all the areas of Scotland all the time, but that's...
No, Von Allison, that battle's over, I think.
We haven't talked about control rooms, and it did feature when we made our visits. Yes. And obviously since then, HMICS has produced its interim report. It would be useful to hear from you how you think the control room closures have had an impact on the way you deliver local policing.
I'll start on that one. I think when you came to visit us, certainly we were going through the transition. As you've alluded to, we've had the interim report. We're now waiting on the full report, which I think is due very shortly, and we'll see what comes out from that. I think it would be unrealistic to say that, you know, there wasn't a change process to go through, as there is with any level of change. But from my perspective, certainly at the moment, we are working well with our new control room. We had built relationships with our new control room. A lot of our processes are very similar to what we had before. Our response times are good. And it's really just a case of continuing to build those relationships and take things forward. Our scrutiny panel, as I've mentioned earlier on, they've had inputs from the command and control team prior to the move, so they had an understanding of what the new control room setup would look like, and came on Tuesday evening to Bilston Glen, and were able to tour the facilities, and were pleased on the whole with what they saw. There was a couple of things they wanted to pick up on, which we would expect, but on the whole they were really pleased. And I think the feedback from other areas when they've gone in and visited the control room was very similar, that they're impressed with how far things have come in terms of the move to the new control areas.
They also switched to.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we lost the control room in May last year. It moved to Govan, and in the last 10 days, as I say, I've met with a lot of elected members and MSPs, etc., and asked them if there was any concerns they wanted to raise. And to date, in the last 10 days, there was nothing raised in terms of the local control room moving up the road. You know, and the call has been taken in the 101 system at Govan.
Alison?
Okay. The other issue that we certainly...
Can I just say also, we've got HMI CS on the... if we agree on the 3rd of December,
okay,
to talk about
good.
The report
that's
on
good. So we'll
control
talk
rooms.
That report. On a local matter, officers in Fife reported to the convener and myself difficulties arising from the size of the hubs into which they were organised, and they said it made it difficult. They were losing time, basically, travelling back and forward to the hub. Have you had an opportunity to review that at all?
We're still looking at that, and we're looking at that as part of the community policing model as well for the ward officers. The hubbing is more... it's more relevant to the response officers because they tend to work out from the hubs. So it is something that we'll continue to look at. I suppose when the reality of it is, Fife had a model previously where we had a lot of stations with very few police officers in them, and there was rationalisation. And that rationalisation was on the cards and started before the move to Police Scotland. So this isn't necessarily something that's new. It's just something that's been evolving. But we will continue to look at that and get the feedback. Our main hub's in the west of Fife, and the new new area commander who's come in is certainly keen to look at that, and she's having those discussions ongoing with her staff, from her inspectors, sergeants and officers, around about how they're finding the hubbing. But it's something that we will continue to look at.
Okay, thank you, Margaret. Yeah, there were two specific issues raised, just about complaints from the public on the control rooms no longer sending officers to incidents that they would previously attended, and also a very odd one, that officers had to use 101 numbers to speak to officers in another area. Is that still the case? It doesn't seem a very sensible way to progress.
No, it's...
Yeah, the 101 system, it's internally in V Division, we can dial around the system quite easily because it's a Cisco system. When I'm travelling up the A74, for example, and I need to speak to someone in our division, obviously I dial 101, and I'm sure that's what colleagues will do elsewhere.
And is there a delay then in getting through? I think that was the suggestion, that they then had to wait in line when they had very important information to transfer.
Well, there's a questionnaire now at where you hit 3 on your mobile if you know the person that you want to speak to, which speeds up the process.
Right, so that's been addressed to an extent.
Yes.
Coming on that as well, I think certainly from some areas, that an officer, you know, or a member of the public feeling that they didn't get a police response when they previously would have, that's down to changes in process as well. We've now in the control rooms got a public assistance desk, so it may be that if somebody's phoning in for something that doesn't necessarily require a police response, it can be dealt with at that first point of contact. So I know Fife had a public assistance desk historically, so that wasn't a new thing for us. So that could have been, I don't know for certain if that's what's behind those comments, but it may be that changes in process, more efficient processes, sometimes people don't necessarily need the police, and indeed sometimes people don't actually want the police to attend. If it's something that's quite low level that they can resolve over the phone, they're sometimes happy to do that. The other thing that we have is obviously a diary system in terms of control room as well. So if somebody phones in with a complaint, they can actually diary a specific time, obviously not an emergency, but a non-emergency call, a routine call, and they can get a diary appointment that suits both the individual and the organisation. And I think that's a massive step forward for the areas that didn't have it before.
I think the specific complaint was a break into a car on three different occasions. And despite that, in no time was a police officer deployed there. So it may be just linking the incidents and the intelligence and process of doing that.
Yeah, that should be resolved now through the control system that we use. It should link with previous incidents.
I think as a final question is about morale, because certainly the survey indicated worryingly the level of morale. And I mean, as you're quite right, policing at grassroots level or anywhere, but basically grassroots level is by consent. If morale's low for the officers, it doesn't make for good policing. Perhaps I'd ask you to comment on how the morale is at your local level and what how the at a national level it can be dealt with to improve the morale amongst officers.
That's a good question. I think the pensions changes have had a significant impact on staff. If you're talking to them about morale, that's probably one of the number one things that they will mention in terms of the extra years that they have to work and what that pension will be at the end of the day. So that has had by far the most significant impact. We're going through the biggest change in public service, you know, and human beings, in my opinion, like consistency in their life, and this change process will take time. But what I would say is, in terms of morale, that, you know, the boys and girls out there on the front line go out on a daily basis, they do a cracking job. I came in Monday morning there and the cells were full at Dumfries and Stranraer. We had Halloween at the weekend, alcohol fueling a lot of violence, but there was a lot of people who were locked up, arrested for assaults, etc. We had one individual locked up for allegedly five rapes. So in my opinion, yeah, morale's low, there's factors. But the staff, it's still a great job. And they're going out there doing a great job. So I would just make that point.
I was asking also what a national level can be done from your new chief constable or whatever up at the top that would help you with morale, because I think they've had issues about, you know, getting you into a pickle where morale fell over.
I think the new chief constable is going to come in, and fundamental to his future will be looking
or
at...
Or her. There are no hers. I should have applied, and you had missed something, yes.
Will be the staff survey, which highlights issues like that, and there'll be an action plan to take that forward. And that'll be, I would imagine, for the new chief and in the command team, and you can see that in some briefing documents, stuff that's come out from Mr. Richard. That's that they recognise that it's an issue, and that they're going to put measures in place to try and address it.
Yes.
Yeah, I would just echo what Mike's saying. I think the staff survey has highlighted several issues, but it's also highlighted some really positive aspects of policing. And the main one, as Mike's described in an operational context there, is that the officers still have a passion for what they do. It's still a vocation. They join policing, as we all did, because actually it's what we want to do. You want to make a difference, and that still comes through very strongly. They have really good relationships with their first-line manager. So for most of our officers, that's their sergeant as their first-line manager. And for us as a command team or for the executive team, it's just recognising that and building on that and thinking out the best ways that we can support those line managers to support their staff. And it's just now we've got the staff survey results, it's that engagement process and then action planning. But not us action planning for our staff, but our staff engaging with us. It's been picked up in a few other themes this afternoon, but actually listening to our staff, because that's what will drive morale up, is actually being listened to and feeling that they can influence how policing moves forward.
Again, I would just echo what my colleagues have said, and I think the kind of welfare and wellbeing aspect and what came through in the staff survey, and I think it was somewhere in the region of 40, you know, whatever percentage it was, felt they were really strongly supported at a first-line manager level. That obviously impacts on the morale piece, and I think the comment that Mr. Finney made as well, yes, at the very start, just around, you know, the negative media. People, everyone that's in the police service, whether you're a police officer or a police member of staff, it's your family. So when the headlines, you know, are slating that organisation, they're slating your family. And I think people take that personally. They take it as a personal slant almost. And that affects morale across the board as well. And I think, again, that's something nationally that you know, we can't stop what's printed in the press, but it does impact on how the guys and girls out there feel when they're delivering the service.
Well, we've gone right up to the buffer, so thank you very much for letting you, and thank you very much for coming and giving your evidence today. And I'm sure back there the boys and girls have been listening to what you've been saying, and if they think that you've not put the case properly because you've told us you're all approachable, you will listen. Thank you very much. Now, I'm just keeping you back a moment because I'm just going to tell you that I formally close this meeting. Thank you, and then if you just wait a minute.